Good evening. I'm Dina McCaffrey, the digital media production teacher here at William Tennent High School. And I have the privilege of introducing television production and filmmaking to some really creative students every single day. I have the best job in the world, I know. We are all storytellers with the ability to raise awareness, educate, motivate, create social change, and of course, to entertain. And if this past year has taught us anything, it's the value of a good Netflix movie. What are you binge watching? So films tell stories. That's why we're here tonight, to see the creative ways in which our young filmmakers can tell a story. This is where the journey begins. Filmmakers, this is your night. Enjoy it. So grab your popcorn, get comfy, and welcome to our virtual film showcase. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Jason Lee to guide us through tonight's program. Enjoy.
Hi, and welcome to William Tennent High School's 6th Annual Behind the Lens Film Festival. I'm Jason Lee. I'm a producer and on-camera talent for PHL 17 Morning News in Philadelphia, also a radio traffic reporter for Total Traffic Networks. But most importantly, I'm a proud graduate of William Tennent High School, class of 1991. We all know this past year has thrown us for a loop. We've had to change our routines, whether it's work, school, spending time with friends. And as we wait for things to get back to normal, we can certainly adapt and change the way we do things. So while you won't get to meet our young filmmakers in person tonight, you'll certainly get to enjoy their work. Like most things, we've had to change how we bring this presentation to you this year. Normally, we open up the competition to students throughout the entire state of Pennsylvania, but for this year, we decided just to keep it homegrown. So you'll enjoy films from our Centennial School District students, from our middle schools, and from our high school as well. We'll even enjoy some of our past winners. It's going to be a great night. So sit back, relax, and let's get started.
Thank you. dangerous. Say something. Real spill. Yeah, yeah.
Last night, all I think about is you. Don't stop, baby, you can walk too. Oh, I'm ever think about you. You know that I'm never gonna lose.
Comes this time each year. memento and a real famous cat all dressed up in red. And he spends the whole year working out in his sled. It's the little Saint Nick.
Banks in 2 weeks. First the Celine, then the Altair. I don't know how he's done it, but he has. I forget that, Connor. We already know that. Think. Both times he's hit him at exactly 8 o'clock on a Tuesday night. They gotta be targeting him because of the security. There ain't enough cops in the world to guard all 200 banks in the city. Could be any of them. If the rumors are true, he's making another hit tonight. That leaves me with less than an hour to figure out his next move. Where is he going? It's gotta be something. Seems like every time I get close to him, I'm still 2 steps behind. But he knows I'm gaining in. He's gonna have to hit something big, because he's not getting another shot at this. Not without getting caught, that is. Could be Woodgrove. Could have more cash than he's ever seen in his life. No, he's not that stupid. Even he knows he's not good enough to get by his 50 security guards. What could it be? The Metro. If I get there in time, I can still catch him.
Your daily scheduled program to bring you a special news bulletin. Residents of Westside Valley Park are sending in reports that look eerily similar to the escaped convict from Westside Asylum.
good. You scared me.
Yeah, it looked like somebody was trying to break into your car. I tried calling you, but I don't know.
It's not my car.
Well, I know you can't drive, but I just wanted to make sure somebody wasn't trying to steal it.
Sorry, I'm really tired. The car alarm started going off. I didn't see your call.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure that somebody wasn't trying to break in. I mean, I knew you can't drive.
I texted my parents. I let them know, but I didn't see anything else.
All right. Well, I just want to make sure you're all right.
All right. Well, I'll check in if anything else happens.
Okay.
Thanks.
Yep.
All right, first day at your new job. You got this.
I can't believe you didn't see that.
Hi, Pat.
Hello, my name is George Fisher. I'm from Klinger Middle School. In addition to being Klinger's librarian, I also teach the middle school media production classes and work with the students to produce morning announcements on Klinger's television channel, KTV. It is my pleasure to be with you this evening to introduce the work of our youngest filmmakers. Congratulations to the students from Klinger and Law College who submitted their films. Let's take a look.
Thank you.
my name is Nicholas Mento, and did somebody mention pandemics? I know the coronavirus is novel and new, but pandemics have hit the U.S. before.
So what pandemic was actually the first to hit the U.S.? The first pandemic to hit the land area of the United States of America was the 1592-1596 Seneca Nation measles epidemic. The first to hit the land where the U.S. was a nation was the 1775-1782 North American smallpox epidemic, which had 11,000 deaths. The worst in U.S. history was the 1918-1920 Spanish flu. It was the second deadliest pandemic in world history. Combined with the fact of the recent end of World War I and a Russian typhus outbreak that was the ninth deadliest in the world, combined to make this time period in history a tough one. I know these unprecedented times are tough, but in order to prevent the coronavirus from becoming as bad as some of the other pandemics in history, make sure to wear your mask when in crowds. And stay 6 feet apart when possible. Remember, we can get through this, and only you can prevent the spread of the virus. I would like to end with some words we have coined during this pandemic. See how many of these you can guess. Thank you.
We gotta put the other and your favorite banana muffin.
I know.
Yay!
My favorite, what does it say on there?
It says protect, attack, and snack. And it came with these banana muffins.
Behind your head snack?
Yep. Yay!
This is OMK07 World News. This morning, at the American Space Agency in Cape Canaveral, Florida, the first manned mission to Mars was successfully launched. In other news, there was a bank robbery at GK National Bank in Flavorville, Ohio. The suspects have been apprehended by local law enforcement. In world news, a large oil field in the Mediterranean exploded. No one was injured or killed, however. The flames are still ablaze. We're about to wrap up here. Thank you for watching. Hold, folks. It's just in from the newsroom. This is world-shattering. I can't believe what I'm reading, ladies and gentlemen. Let's go to the videotape. The cutest dog in the world takes a bath! Look how cute he is!
Who's there?
Needle.
Needle who?
Need a little help getting in the door.
now, please stay tuned for some special greetings from our William Tennent High School and Behind the Lens Film Festival alumni.
Hi, I'm Noah Chast, a William Tennent grad from 2016, and right now I'm working as a multimedia journalist and reporter in Central Oregon, the places you can go, right? I just want to say how grateful I am for all the production classes, BWTV, everything at William Tennent that helped me get to a good spot in college to go into this major and eventually get a job. So, Ms. McCaffrey, thank you, everyone at BWTV. Thank you for all your hard work.
Hi, I'm Lauren Deal, William Tennent class of 2018. I'm currently a student at Temple University, and I'll be a senior in the fall. My major is Media Studies and Production with a concentration in media business and entrepreneurship. My best advice for young filmmakers or anyone else going into the media industry is don't be afraid to put yourself out there, because connections are everything, and the worst that anyone could say is no.
Hey everybody, my name is Ben Medland. I graduated from William Tennent in 2017. I'm now currently living in Kentucky, working for a D3 college called Center College. Here I'm the athletic communications assistant, handling all the video production needs of the athletic department here. I just want to say congratulations to everybody who is involved with this film festival, whether you win or lose and an award, it's something special to be a part of. And I think myself and along with all the other alumni who are working in this industry are direct examples of what is to come out of this program. So congrats and good luck.
Hi, my name is Katie Pressler, William Tennent class of 2013. I then went on to Kutztown University and graduated in 2017. And now I am a producer, editor, and videographer. My biggest piece of advice to aspiring filmmakers is to get as much experience as you can. Sign up for clubs, ask questions. All of your hard work will pay off one day.
Hey, William Tennent. My name's Joe Tui. I was a graduate from the class of 2016 and a participant and winner, not a big deal, seriously, don't make a big deal out of it, in the inaugural Behind the Lens Film Contest. I'm currently the director of marketing for a company by the name of AuctionEasy.com. And you may be thinking to yourself, that's not necessarily a job that's within the industry. You would be correct, but it requires a lot of similar skill sets that a job within the industry would be. I use Adobe programs on the daily, like Photoshop and Premiere, and I'm using a lot of the similar traits and skill sets that were learned from the position that you're sitting in today. You know, attention to detail, hard work, just having a tedious mind for stuff like this. I have to put all that towards my work, and that's an important thing to know. What you're doing today, while it's great for things in the industry, and I wish you nothing but luck in that, it's not an end-all be-all. The skills you're learning are life lessons, and the people you're meeting right now, like Mrs. McCaffrey, are people who are going to put you in the right direction for whatever you end up doing in life. You guys are ambassadors for the future of William Tennent, and I wish you nothing but success in whatever you do next, whatever that may be.
Hi everyone, my name is Carly Showmaker and I am William Tennent class of 2015. I currently own and operate my very own production company, Showmaker Productions, which, fun fact, was started right where you are right now in BWTV Studios and has evolved into my full-time job. It's crazy, never give up on your dreams. So if I could offer you a couple pieces of advice, there are two things. The first is network, network, network. If you think someone in the field is making really cool work, don't be afraid to reach out to them online, whether it's your favorite director, your favorite content creator on social media. With all the social media that exists nowadays, reach out to them on LinkedIn, Instagram. The worst thing that can happen is they don't answer you, but the best thing that can happen is they do answer you. And then all of a sudden you have someone who's able to offer you some advice and a connection in the field for your future. The second is to never stop creating. So in any downtime that you have, constantly be creating. Take your camera everywhere with you. Even if you don't know what you're filming for, eventually you can turn that into a sizzle reel, a fun video on YouTube, and start gaining traction. We are so lucky to live in a time where content creation is such a huge part of our society. So take advantage of that and get yourself out there. Get your name out there. Never stop creating and keep enjoying what you're doing.
Hi, my name is John Newman, and I graduated from William Tennent in 2016. And Mrs. McCaffrey's class, Digital Production 1 and Digital Production 2 at the time, was kind of where I found my love for video production. I had no idea I would want to work in the field of media and film, but stuff that she taught us in those classes in high school was stuff that I actually was learning my first couple of years at Temple, so it kind of had me ahead of the curve. While I was at Temple, I had the chance to intern at a few different places, including The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon and Last Week Tonight with John Oliver, as well as working as a camera operator for the Phillies part-time, which is what I still do. I'll be working there tonight, so I kind of run one of the cameras down there. And you know, since graduating from Temple, I've been working on a variety of different TV shows and movies and commercials that have been in the New York and Pennsylvania area, just freelancing. If I had any piece of advice for you guys, it would be to, like I said, listen to what Miss McCaffrey says. She's not lying when she tells you the importance of making sure you know the basics of the camera and the basics of editing software, because you're going to be learning that, and you need to know that when you enter this field. So you guys are going to be way ahead if you're learning that in high school. And then also, video is everywhere. So, you know, you go to an event, you go to a concert, you go to a sporting event, there's cameras there. Every small businesses, big businesses, you know, they need video to promote their products. Movies, commercials, TV, you see video everywhere. We're just, you know, consumed by it here in 2021. So there's so many opportunities. And if you want to work in the field, I think it's a great, fun field to work in. You definitely have to keep your head up, and you have to take opportunities as they come, and learn as you go. But I think working in film and media is a great thing. And you guys, by taking Ms. McCaffrey's class, you've already taken the first step. So I hope you all continue to work in this wonderful field, and maybe I'll work with you someday. Good luck, everybody.
Mental health is complicated because, unlike a physical condition, it's invisible. I'm Dr. Walsh. I'm a school psychologist here at William Tennant High School in Centennial School District. So I like to use an analogy like the invisible backpack. So all the students come to school, they have their Chromebooks, they have their, you know, notebooks, pens, pencils, whatever they need. But they also come with what's called this invisible backpack, things that you can't see, that you're carrying around every day. And in that backpack can be a lot of things that are positive and good and help you get through the day and be successful, and they're called protective factors. But a lot of students, unfortunately, carry around what's invisible, which are called risk factors, which basically are things that can help push forward negative outcomes. And what the problem is that your family, your teachers, your friends, nobody can see what's in that invisible backpack. So if you have a lot of risk factors, it's going to be a lot harder for you than other students who have a lot more protective factors. And that's where mental health comes in.
I went a long time without help. I asked for help, but nobody would hear me. I told one certain person, and that certain person did know, but didn't really do anything about it, and that's not what a friend should do. And I did ask to go see a doctor or a therapist, but it was passed off as hormones or something silly like that, when I knew it was more than that, but nobody would hear me, and that was probably one of the hardest parts, because I knew what I was going through, I knew that I needed help, and nobody would reach out that hand.
I think the most difficult part of my mental health situation is just having to cope with it every single day. It's not easy coming to school and acting like you're okay, or just hiding how you feel, because people can easily tell. They're gonna easily see you, and if you look upset, teachers are gonna ask you, your parents are gonna ask you, even your friends or anybody else, and then it can either turn into a big situation, or they can just give you advice and let it go after that.
People noticed that my grades were dropping badly. They noticed that I stopped eating a lot. I slept a lot. I wasn't motivated to do the things that I used to like painting and playing the guitar or piano, just the simple things. I just wouldn't do those anymore. And it took a while for them to notice, but once they did, and once they listened, I did get that help.
Some students are really proactive and they're self-advocates for themselves, and they tell their parents what's going on, or they tell a brother or sister who then tells their parents. Or they even tell their own doctor, you know, at maybe a well visit, that they feel like something's up. Other students, they are not as willing for a number of reasons. It could be the dynamics in the household, that they don't want to put more stress on their parents, or there's financial issues and they don't want to add more to it, or it could be a religious reason or a cultural reason. So I think outside of school, the most important thing is to make sure that somebody in your home life knows that you need help. And if you're not comfortable telling that person, just find somebody in your school life, an adult, that you feel would be a good way to open up that conversation between you and your parents, or a student and their parents, because the breakdown and miscommunication between home and school is where sometimes major problems occur.
The idea that we can't talk about suicide or we're going to cause more is more than dated. It's a dangerous idea. And we realize that in areas where we're not talking about this, we're still seeing higher rates of suicide. And like, people are still, unfortunately, dying. And so talking about it, sharing, connecting, those are what fight the stigma. Those are what fight the shame. And then we can get people the help they need.
Would be is that the more we talk about it, the less there will be a stigma about it, and the less there's a stigma, the more people are going to feel comfortable coming forward and asking for help when they need it. And you don't need to have a major mental health condition and need significant amount of help. You could also just be going through a hard time and you just want to reach out so it doesn't turn into something worse. So there's no level of severity at all ever with mental health that needs to be determined in order to just ask for help.
It is incredibly tragic. It is a way for us to bind together as a community and to say that we are not alone and that we are here for you. And it is a way for us to fight something together, something that's genuinely threatening. It's a health crisis. I think that's the underlying message here. This is like any other health crisis. It just has, you know, like every health crisis, it has its own solution. The solution here is relatively simple at this point. It doesn't require a miracle cure. It requires conversation and it requires empathy, which is something that I think we can all appreciate.
Every year, 6.4 million pounds of trash are dumped into the ocean. Hundreds of animals, along with their habitats, are affected by the waste. To help, support local conservations and recycle any litter you find lying around. These are small steps everyone can take to prevent harm to the world we live in today.
Welcome back to another episode of Who Wants to Be a Safe Driver? What's the first thing you should do when you get into a car? Is it A, put on your seatbelt, or B, put your music on really loud?
Oh man, turn it up. Turn up the music.
What's one thing you should check while driving? Is it A, your phone, or B, your mirrors?
Your phone?
I can't.
This is Person A. Person A always follows safe driving protocol before getting in the car. She always wears her seatbelt, she puts her phone on Do Not Disturb, and she is always aware of her surroundings. Person A is a safe driver.
Person B is not like Person A.
She forgets to put on her seatbelt, she keeps her notifications on, and doesn't always pay attention to her surroundings. Person B is not a safe driver. Be like Person A. Be a safe driver.
I'm very sorry I interrupted your birthday party.
My dear child, this is not a birthday party.
Of course not. This is the nun's birthday party.
Nun's birthday? I just don't quite understand.
Now, statistics prove that you one birthday.
That you're just one birthday every year.
But there are 364 on birthdays.
Precisely why we're gathered here to cheer.
Well, then is my own birthday, too.
It is.
What a small world this is.
In that case, a very, very birthday.
To me?
To you.
A very, very birthday.
For me?
For you.
Now blow the candle out, my dear, and make your wish come true.
So how do you feel?
Honestly, depressed. Sometimes I have a breakdown and then I just fall apart and I'm broken inside. Hang on, I gotta catch my breath. I just always feel like I have this obligation to be happy, like everything's fine when I'm not, and I can't do anything about it. I might stay broken for a little bit, but eventually I'll put myself back together. I've been keeping a lot in, having a lot of anger. Nobody cares until the worst shall happen. Until you think that your parents would always be there for you. But it's just a show. Sometimes I wonder if I'm wanted in this world. Like, what is my purpose? I don't see one yet. Somehow I survive through all the pain that is caused. All the fighting, yet nothing got accomplished from it. I don't know what's next. Somehow I don't feel the same after every day, just worse and worse, and my sadness shows through the cracks. It happens over and over, day after day. I'm not sure if I can even call you my friend.
While it may look easy, filmmaking involves planning, filming, and editing. For every 1 minute of video, there's most likely 1 hour of footage behind that. So tonight, we'd like to recognize some of those films which showed artistic excellence.
Well, that's going to do it for this year. Congratulations to all of our filmmakers, and keep creating. And we hope to see you in person for next year's Behind the Lens Film Festival. Good night, everybody.